So hello everyone, thanks so much for joining us. Welcome to the second seminar this term in the Centre for Applied Sociology at the University of Greenwich's seminar series. And we're very honoured today to have two speakers with us. We are going to be joined by Gloria Morrison, who is campaign coordinator for JENGBA, Joint Enterprise Not Guilty by Association, a really important grassroots organisation which has been representing hundreds of young people across people from across the country who have been caught up in the joint enterprise doctrine, which if it's a doctrine you're unfamiliar with, Gloria and Becky will both be telling us more about it this afternoon. And as well as we're also being joined by Becky Clarke, who is a lecturer in criminology at Manchester Metropolitan University, who has recently published a really important report on the effects of the joint enterprise doctrine on women and girls. And it's going to be talking about that research and how it relates to the work that Gloria has been doing. So we're going to hear from both speakers for around half an hour or so in total, and then we're going to open up to questions. If you would like to, if you do come up with any questions while they're presenting to us, you can use the chat function in the bottom of the screen, the Q&A function, I should say, in the bottom of your screen to write in your questions, which we'll read out at the end. If you're directing your questions towards a specific person, please do let us know. So we can have a bit of discussion and chat and question and a bit more information towards the end. Right, so without further ado, I'd like to give the floor to Gloria Morrison from JENGBA to tell us a little bit about the organisation, the work they do and the issues that they are confronting. Thanks so much, Gloria.
Thank you, Adam. Thank you very much for inviting us along to this talk. For many of you who are not familiar with joint enterprise, I'll explain how I found out about joint enterprise, so that will give you an idea of what it is. My sons, I've got three sons, my oldest son, his best friend, was charged with a murder, even though he was actually a victim of an assault. And I thought at the time, I knew he was charged, but I didn't go to court because I thought, well, if you haven't actually murdered anybody, you can't go to prison for murder because that's impossible. But he actually was convicted along with three others. If you Google, that's 14 years ago, if you and given a life, mandatory life sentence. So if you Google joint enterprise then, you would get a joint specialist in Australia. That was it. There was nothing really on the internet about it or what it actually meant. So what it does mean is that if two or more people commit an offence, and it doesn't have to be murder, it can be attached, it's a doctrine that can be attached to any form, any criminality. So but JENGBA's mainly supporting people who've been convicted of murder. So if it's two or more go on to commit an offence and one person goes beyond what the other person thought they were going to do, but that doesn't matter. You're a secondary party, and that means you will go to prison for life with the principal, with the person who's actually done the murder. Now, this doesn't need to be involve a weapon. This can be a punch, a one punch, or it can just be it can be self-defense, but you can still go to prison for murder. But when it happened to my son's best friend, I kind of, because one main, firstly, he's black, and all the boys that were in the dock were black. So my instinct then was that this has got to be racist. I mean, if you don't know who's done what, and what's called in our courts is cutthroat defence, which means everybody starts blaming one another. So the juries are kind of looking at people thinking, well, someone's got to go, especially if it's a murder, you want someone to go to prison for it because, someone's lost a loved one. But so I was trying to find justice for him because he was like a son to me. He'd been in and out of my house since he was 11. But it was very, very difficult. And I started with a group called London Against Injustice, and more cases were coming to that were joint enterprise cases. So we're starting to gather a picture of the courts. And this is like, we're talking 2006, 2007. Interestingly, the last man who was hung in this country, Derek Bentley, he was a joint enterprise case. So the story of Derek Bentley is he's with another boy on a burglary, and his co-defendant has got a gun, and he says to his co-defendant, let him have it, which means the police officer, let him have the gun. but the co-defendant actually shot the police officer dead. And Derek Bentley was hung for that because it was a joint enterprise murder. He was responsible because he said, let him have it, even though there was massive outcry. But the development of joint enterprise over the years has been very policy-driven and very media-driven as well, actually. I met Janet Cunliffe a few years after Ken went to prison, and her son, Jordan Cunliffe, was convicted of the murder of Gary Newlove. And the son, in particular, picked that news, that story up when he was on trial, because they were talking about feral Britain and broken Britain. And actually, they had a petition out to try and bring back the death penalty. If you go back and look at the archives of the Sun at the time, they are trying to bring back the death penalty. And they're saying the majority of the British public want the death penalty brought back. So when Janet told me about her son, because not only is Jordan Cunliffe 15, he didn't touch the victim, he didn't have any shoes on, he didn't kick the victim, he's blind. He was registered blind at the time. So, you know, when I met Jan, that was via, it's just going to go on our website, actually, was via a documentary, Panorama, we were making. They were trying to make it about Jordan, actually, but the judge in his case had put a gagging order on the fact that Jordan was blind. Begs the questions, why are they frightened to actually reveal something like that? But Janet and I met, and when, you know, we talked and we realized that we're locking up blind children and, you know, locking up innocent people, we decided we needed to start a campaign. So we founded the campaign, co-founded it in 2009. We launched in 2010. In 2013, we got in front of the Justice Select Committee. They did a follow-up inquiry in 2015. Becky and Patrick Williams did a very important report, which is called Dangerous Associations, Joint Enterprise Gangs and Racism, which I'm sure Becky will talk about. But that took us to 2016, where the Supreme Court certified a question to say, did joint enterprise over-criminalise secondary parties? We could intervene with that because we, at that point, had something like 600 cases. We now are representing over 1,000 prisoners that have been convicted under joint enterprise. And the youngest of them is 13 years old. It's a girl and a boy, both 13 years old, where they were given life sentences. We're the only country in Europe that give children life sentences. We're the only country in Europe that send children to prison for life. And we're the only country in Europe that uses joint enterprise. Nowhere else does. Anywhere that has British jurisdiction, so the West Indies still have joint enterprise. America has a thing called felony murder rule, which is a similar kind of thing. You don't have to be the perpetrator, but if you're linked somehow. Now, the evidence in joint enterprise cases is really tenuous. It can be a phone call. It can be a YouTube video. God forbid, if you like grime. If they can somehow link a group of people by these tenuous associations, and one of them is a principal, and they can prove the principal, they don't always actually even need to prove the principal. Often they'll use someone they've got the least evidence on, make them the principal, and try to say that they're the gang, they're the ringleader, because they haven't actually got any physical evidence on them. I know it all sounds like science fiction, but it's not. It's absolutely true. So 2016, when the Supreme Court decided whether joint enterprise over-criminalised secondary parties, we got a result which said that the law had taken a wrong turn in 1984. Interesting use of a year, I think. But it hadn't taken a wrong turn in the UK, it had taken a wrong turn in Hong Kong, and it had taken a wrong turn in Jamaica by using those two cases and saying that they had been relying on foresight and not intention. So the two elements of joint enterprise before is what you knew someone else was going to do, so the foresight element, and what you intended to do. So now they said in 2016, you had to go back to intention. So what someone's, prove in court what someone's intention is. Unfortunately though, if you've been convicted under joint enterprise, you can't go back to court of appeal because there are no ground, you have to have fresh evidence to go back to the court of appeal. But if there was no actual evidence to convict you, except for the fact that you foresaw someone else might do something, it is really, really it's impossible to get through the court of appeal. But we have gone back with appeals. We went back, the first batch of appeals known as R versus Johnson, and they were all denied. They were all waiting to see what the Supreme Court decision was going to be. So everyone was jumping up and down, especially in prisons, thinking, oh, I'm going to finally get justice. But they were all denied R versus Johnson. The next lot we took through was children with learning difficulties. who had a learning ages of 6 and 7. They were 13 and 14 at the time. They're not they were secondary parties, which mean they did not commit the actual offence. But Lord Thomas, the Lord Chief Justice at the time, said they had a fair trial. They were tried in adult court. We had a mediator there, said, if you ask children with learning difficulties tag questions, that's questions that are leading, they will always nearly answer in the affirmative because they won't say, I don't understand. They don't want to look like they're idiots, so they won't answer, you know. So that mediator said they weren't understanding the process. And anyway, the language in a court, everybody should go there. It's very, very complex. I mean, they tried to change joint enterprise to parasitic accessorial liability because too many people were finding us if they looked up joint enterprise. And that's why our campaign is so strong, because we're all, you know, it's all family supporting and supporters who don't believe that their loved ones should be in prison. So they knocked back the children. And then we went forward with a case of a boy who's diagnosed with autism once he went to prison. So that was fresh evidence because he wasn't diagnosed with autism outside. His mum was always trying to find out what was wrong with him. They had asthma after asthma after asthma. It was a spontaneous fight in a shop. All he does is throw his phone on the floor. He's with a boy who is homeless, who's carrying a knife and uses the knife concealed. So Alex didn't even know he had a knife and didn't know he'd used it. They fled the shop and unfortunately there was a fatality. So we went back with that on the grounds that the lead expert in the world, Simon Baron Cohen, on autism said that, you know, someone with autism wouldn't be able to foresee what someone else was going to do. And Lord Chief Thomas said that because Alex's mum's a psychologist, she taught her somehow to pretend to be autistic, to pull the wool over the eyes of the lead expert in the world on autism. So that's what we're up against in terms of the legal establishment and the judges not accepting that they got it wrong. We didn't get it wrong. They were interpreting the law wrong. It's common law, which means it goes from judge to judge. Who appoints the judges? Other judges. So, you know, this is the establishment elite saying, oh, well, there's a mistake. There's been a problem. And the other thing they did was in the Supreme Court judgment, they said only in cases that can prove substantial injustice can go back to the Court of Appeal. So it doesn't really matter that you were tried under the wrong law or that you were you didn't have a fair trial. You can only go back to the Court of Appeal if you can prove substantial injustice. Now, we've tried to get them to certify. You can only get a certified question in the Supreme Court what substantial injustice means, because we're saying, well, if you're sitting in a prison cell serving a mandatory life sentence, and these sentences are huge. I mean, they're, you know, they're 28s, 29s for things that young boys have not done. They're serving these massively long sentences. So they won't certify it. They refuse to say what substantial injustice is. And so we have not got anybody through bar John Crilly. He's been the only person who had his conviction overturned since R versus Jogi, which is the Supreme Court decision. Now, Jogi himself went back, was retried, and we went to his trial. There's no way that was manslaughter. It didn't make any sense. There was one witness who came and said he was saying, come on, come on. The same thing in Bentley, let him have it. He's saying, come on, telling him to leave, not to carry out violence. And they still found him guilty of manslaughter. So something very odd goes on in the courtroom. I do understand it because I've listened to judges and they're not impartial. But but over the years of campaigning, and I talk about being like sleepwalking at the beginning of this campaign because I thought our justice system was one of the best in the world. I now think it's one of the worst because we have joint enterprise. It's a fascist use of law. But the children's cases are really, really tragic because, like I said, no other country puts children as young as 13 into prison. The men's cases are, the predominantly the cases that we're supporting are men. But the women's cases always, always bothered me because they're balmy. They're just balmy. A woman in the bath whose husband gets shot in the front room is serving a 30-year sentence for that murder. When, you know, if you're going to shoot, you get your husband shot, I don't think you'd have a bath. But besides all that, the women's cases were something that really, really bothered me. We've had lots of different academic research. Most of it's on our website. But After Becky and I are now really good friends, and she knew that I kept saying, you know, someone should do something about the women's cases. Then, you know, wonderfully, she did get commissioned, her and Catherine Chadwick, to do this piece of research into our cases and the women. And I'll hand over to Becky now to explain her findings, because it was exactly as I said, well, I say balmy, but she would obviously couch it in very nice, good academic language. Is that okay?
Thanks, Gloria. Adam, did you want to come in there before I take the mic?
No, please. Thank you very much, Becky. Go ahead.
Okay. Well, I hope I won't over academicize it, if that's even a word. But I think, you know, first of all, thanks, Adam, for bringing me into your event. It's returning the favour. Adam's come and spoken at a number and been part of the conversation, I suppose, about particularly about joint enterprise and the use of a racialized gang narrative, which is where many of us started. And it kind of becomes a thread that you follow. And when we did the Dangerous Associations work, you know, which is unbelievably 5 or 6 years ago now, we did see those cases of women, you know, a woman training to be a midwife in a car park had lost her shoes, and, you know, and just these cases did stand out. But it always felt like, and I have to acknowledge my own failing here, if anybody had really asked me, I'd have gone, but it's just the odd case. But we didn't really know. And this is the first thing perhaps to say about joint enterprise. It remains hidden. You know, there is no official data, information, evidence about how it's being used, the scale of it. And that's why the campaign like Gembers is so crucial and so important, because it allows us to see something which is hidden. And it's for us as individuals, or for us collectively, to ask ourselves, why is it hidden? Is that by design, or is that by accident? What's going on here? But yeah, the research enables us to kind of then further open up that process. So I'm going to do something a little bit different in the next sort of 15 minutes or so, 20 minutes. And I'm going to focus in, it is about injustice, and these are stories of injustice. But I'd like to think a bit broader than the legal system, because I've always had this sense as well, and I know it's something Patrick and I wrote at the end of Dangerous Associations, you could probably get rid of joint enterprise, but you would still see these very distinct and punitive strategies being used against young people from the Black community, okay? You could get rid of joint enterprise, and I think you would still find the, you know, many of the women that we found on joint enterprise convictions caught up in the criminal justice system, being criminalized, being punished. And so there's something beyond the law, even though for me, I've often said that joint enterprise is like this lens, and it allows you to look at things in a different way, because ultimately people are not convicted for what they've done. They're convicted because of who they are, or more specifically, who they're perceived to be. And that's where gendered narratives that are rooted with class-based stigma, that have, you know, racist stereotypes running through them, you know, this sort of who you are perceived to be, perceived in the courtroom, but also I think perceived in the wider public space, and the media is central to that. So that's something I'm going to focus on today, knowing it's a social sciences series rather than legal. We have got an event actually coming out of Greenwich next week with the Jeep project, which is kind of like a UK-based innocence project that's more legal. And I'm sure if you were interested in that, we could get you into that event. So I don't want to dismiss the importance of some of that, but I'm really interested in taking us in a little bit of a different direction. So I'm hoping it's going to work, and I've pitched this right, and we'll I'm going to share my screen now, because I've got a couple of diagrams and quotes that I'd like to share. So I hope that's okay, and please, yeah, any questions you've got, you know, do bring them to the discussion. So I mean, here's the report, and it's kind of front screen of the report here. And I think it's always really important to say, and particularly with the women, that they come from all corners of England and Wales, urban cities, rural backwaters, coastal villages, you know, and that was something that really struck me, because I think when we'd done the work around dangerous associations, partly because of the way in which I think particularly policing teams operate in urban areas differently, we did see joint enterprise for young people from the Black community being centred around, you know, the key cities, London, Manchester, Birmingham, Liverpool. But, you know, joint enterprise is all over England and Wales, and that's important to recognise. And I think it's important we'll start with the kind of the headlines, and I really want to kind of, I suppose it's a bit of a sucker punch. This is where we really get to see what's going on. So when we started the project, we knew that on the campaign database, when we went back through the paper files and different spaces, there were kind of 60, 70 women on Jemba's sort of campaign database. So we had a starting point and we had contact with some of those women. Some of them had lost touch in the prison system and we had to try and re-establish that. We also set off a process where we tried to snowball through those women on the landings in the prisons, but also through other organisations. Women in Prison were a great supporter of our work. We tried to find other women hidden in the system, because that's where people are. They're hidden in the system, serving life sentences often. So we had 109 women by the end of sort of the summer last year, but they're still coming. Gloria and I spoke on the phone earlier today and she told me about another woman that's been in touch just this week. So they are still coming. Of those 109 women, almost 20 of them have been convicted since the Supreme Court ruling. So this isn't just about historic cases, retrospective cases. This continues. Over three quarters of the women and girls are convicted of murder or manslaughter. And so because of those serious violent offence convictions, they're serving long prison sentences, average 15 years, 21, 25, 28, 30 years. And this is where it becomes really balmy, as Gloria said. You know, 90% of the women engage in no violence, and that's acknowledged in the court process as well. You know, it's not the women saying, you know, there's an acknowledgement of who did what, and that actually women aren't necessarily the principal. They're never established as the violent party. The very small handful of women who did engage in an altercation, a physical altercation with the victim, it was a push. Somebody jumped on somebody's back, a slap, and one woman used a broom handle. Most of the victims tragically died by a knife point or by a sharp implement. Almost half of the women are not at the scene when the victim dies. And that's a real strong thread, similar percentage for the 250 prisoners we engage with for the dangerous associations. People not at the scene, yet viewed culpable and convicted for the offence. The youngest girl convicted, as Gloria said, was a child of 13, and the oldest woman in prison currently is 68. So this is, you know, this is impacting on such a wide range of women. Women who are from Black, Asian or other minoritized backgrounds, and that can include women from the traveller community, were almost a quarter of the sample of women who we identified. And there's something interesting going on there, which, you know, I think we begin to understand, but they're convicted of less serious offences, so they were more likely to be kidnapped, drug or manslaughter, but actually are receiving similar sentence lengths to white British women, you know, confirming what we know from the analysis from Lammy's report or otherwise, which is Black women, Asian women, other minoritised women will be treated more harshly in a system, in this criminal justice system. And then we start to get to, and this, you know, this was part of the project that I think we went to find, but you don't quite prepare yourself to hear what that feels like. You know, the pain that then comes with life sentences for women and men with children. 73 of the women are mothers, and between these women, they have 117 children who are now living without their mums, and sadly, in this very moment, won't have seen their mums for over a year. You know, so that's the real harm impact immediate. What we've sought to do, so how the hell do we explain that? How do we get to a point where those headline findings make sense? Like, how can you say, well, this is why that's happening? And I think one of the things that Patrick and I had done for Dangerous Associations, and Catherine and I took forward again in this project, is to keep our minds focused on the process of criminalisation. Where are those key points from an event happening to the conviction and somebody ending up in the prison system? What are the decision-making factors? What are the critical points? And in some ways, as much as anything, it keeps us focused, because it's dead easy to get drawn into women's lives. And, you know, women's lives do become relevant, as you'll see in a minute, but not to explain why they committed the crime, who caused the crime. they didn't commit the crime. Women's lives can help tell us why perhaps they are perceived in ways and treated differently in the criminal justice system. But as I say today, I'm just going to focus on, there's this line running along the bottom called media reporting of the case. And it was always something we were interested in, and it's something that I think since we published the report, I've thought about quite a lot, really. And you know, when speaking to families, understanding the impact of media reporting, the women spoke about it invariably in their accounts as well. So I'm going to take a focus on that. But I'm going to start with some of the women's, their voices, their experiences, and they tell us about the prosecution strategies. They tell us how and why they think they were convicted in these cases. Jenna tells us about how, for her, her abuse, sexual abuse that she experienced, was used by the prosecution to paint a bad picture of her. They actually, in the prosecution, they said that she manipulated men for alcohol and drugs. She was a child and a teenager at the time. You know, we hear echoes, we hear these narratives elsewhere, don't we, in these sort of, in cases of child sexual exploitation. I just don't think they believed me. Ada tells us something about the ways in which women who are living on the margins of society are perceived to be culpable because of their lifestyle, the way that they're living, where they're living, who they're spending their time with. They said in it together, scruffy, unkempt. Poppy, I should have foreseen what would happen, known what would happen before I agreed to go to the victim's house. They made me out to be a bad mum as my kids had already been taken away. So we start to see the prosecution is focusing on a woman's character, her life, her actions leading up to or after an event. Willow, my role in the crime was deemed to be this woman full of hate who somehow managed to convince everybody to end up fighting. The focus was on me and the fact that I was a woman. This age-old gendered sort of narrative of women as manipulative or as the kind of facilitators of violence, even if they are not violent. Okay, and we, you know, we can look at popular media cases, but we can look at a range of examples of this. Those are their words. Let's look at some of the words from the prosecution and the media alongside. So in Willow's case, she encouraged them, urged them on. I mean, and the media take that step further and listen to that gendered, egged the Cody on like a banshee. She's a banshee. Jenna says, they kept saying to the media, in it to kill together, how it took me a long time to get ready. That was this party girl. It's this focus on her and her looks and her appearance. And there's some young girls in these cases, and there's this common thread here about, I mean, this media report on Anya is bizarre, really, because they focus on the fact that she's roaming the streets, that she drinks alcohol, they repeatedly go back to this, and that she smokes. And they say, not like a typical teen, which I find, you know, bizarre if anybody thinks about what typical teenagers, well, you know, in COVID and not in COVID, would be doing. And with Brooke, the judge says, you have previous for drunken, loutish behaviour. The media says, Larry, mouthy, binge drink killer, ex-public school girl. You know, these are the ways in which. So I think we start to see the relationship between the media and the judge. And, you know, often because of the law, the media hides behind, well, we're only reporting what's been said in the courtroom. We're just sort of extending on what's been said, but we're not saying anything different. And that's what we've got to do. But there, you know, there's questions about what they're doing here. I'm going to move into just some further contesting voices from the women, really, of these media discourses. But I want to also show these cases because we start to see the layering of gendered narratives, of racist stereotypes, of class stigma coming in here. Lisa, in the media, is honey trap girl, only used for black or mixed race women and girls. Honey trap girl, good riddance honey trap killer. That actually comes from a media article about Lisa being at risk of deportation. Girls in gang culture, gang violence. But when we listen to Lisa, we hear something very different. I was mentally weak and unstable, so I accepted all of his abuse. I was unaware of their criminal activity, that he had a knife. I apparently lured my boyfriend to be murdered. Shanice, the prosecution say, quoted in the media, arranged the flat, not at the scene. The media say the gang, and make reference to replica guns. For Shanice, she says, it was argued in court that although I did not personally cause harm to anyone, I was guilty by association to those who did. Venetia, there's this anger at his, the prosecution said that she was angry at his infidelity and the dishonour that his behaviour brought upon her and her family, and the language here, this dishonour. She's an evil wife seeking a divorce, says the media. But when Nisha speaks about her experience, she says they didn't understand Pakistani culture. The defence didn't want to use it, even though the prosecution are alluding to it. It was skipped over briefly. Yasmin, cold, cruel, calculating, chilling. These become very gendered words because we're starting to point to how women are different to what would be expected from that feminine ideal. So she's not warm. She's not caring. She's cold. She's calculating. She's chilling. The wife had tired of him, said the judge. Lovers jailed for shotgun murder, cruel wife, cheating wife, ruthless, said the media. Yasmin says, the prosecution said I let him in, said I was having an affair and I wanted rid of the husband. He, the judge, said you're very clever. Interestingly, for women like Yasmin, who arguably are more middle-class women, more affluent women, this concept of cleverness, of manipulation that is gendered about women who are not now out of place, but actually knowing or clever. Oops. So I'm, you know, Catherine Chadwick and I, as we've started to think through some of this, we've been thinking about this concept of visibility. Certain things are rendered really hyper-visible, especially for the women in the cases, in a way that doesn't happen for the men, you know. Women will be put on the stand as co-defendants when they know that they are not the violent person. They'll be on the stand for much longer than the male co-defendants. Yet being on the stand is focused on particular aspects of their lives whilst others are rendered invisible. Kyra, none of my DV or mental health or addiction was really brought up in the trial. The harassment and DV from the victim, his drug use, the fact that he pimped me out, I was just made out to be this manipulative, jealous ex. It's actually a very small number of cases that are like Kyra's, where the victim is somebody who is an ex-partner and there is violence. Probably more so it would be, as we see in Savannah's case, there's no mention of his violence, the domestic violence to me. The defence, the QC, said it would affect my case. So they're being advised by defence teams, This will make you a bad witness for the defence if this is brought up. You know, you're unreliable. Do not bring this into the courtroom. Savannah is in the dock for allowing the death of her baby daughter. And the man she sat next to in the dock has killed her child. I was disgusted. I sat in the same dock as the man who hurt my daughter. They truly believed I knew or saw something. They didn't think hard enough. They didn't believe me. You know, so we're here, you know, some of this is so echoing of sexual violence, rape trials, this context where prosecution, the justice system doesn't work. It doesn't work to acknowledge the failure to protect women and their children in their lives, yet it seeks to criminalise and punish women. And, you know, as I move to sort of close on the input, I want to think about what this means for these women, because it's significant. These narratives and the media's role in this is significant, but I think it extends beyond these women as well. Like I say, joint enterprise becomes like this lens we can see things through that have a broader resonance. So we see these gendered narratives, they become and we said this for Dangerous Associations with the gang narrative, they become like a resource for the prosecution in the courtroom. They become the way that the prosecution signals something to the jury without even really saying it. We know what we're talking about. But the circulation of these narratives is really key to the value, how they are produced and reproduced. And so I am kind of asking the question for us to think about together, like, what's the relationship between the state and the media in these cases? Is it simply about echoing? Because I think that's what the media would have us think. But I wonder also, actually, if there is something much more important to understand about the power to fix the story through the process of selection, to amplify and render visible certain issues in that production of the news and how that happens. And I'm going to finish on a slide. And am I okay, Adam? Just two more minutes. About how we might conceptualize this. And, you know, this is sort of thinking in progress. And I'm going to take a statement from Catherine and I that we discussed and agreed today, but then I'm going to use some quotes from others here. So I'm going to use, the injustice of joint enterprise convictions can be understood through the process of criminalisation. And that is our, you know, our main argument. The focus on that process of criminalisation is key. This process is the responsibility of the state, undoubtedly. We shouldn't take that accountability away from there. And I wouldn't want to. But it is facilitated by hegemonic narratives that are reproduced by the media, by political voices and by wider society. Baroness Kennedy, who wrote a kind of an update of her book, Eve Was Framed, to call it Eve Was Shamed, and published a few years ago, said, all the legal reforms have produced only marginal advances. These gendered myths and stereotypes still pervade the courts. We can also draw on Stuart Hall and colleagues from the Centre for Cultural Studies and their policing the crisis work around mugging. And they say the media do not themselves autonomously create news items, rather they are cued in. So there's something going on here, there's a relationship. They're cued in to specific news topics by regular and reliable institutional sources. So we start to see this relationship as something beyond just reporting what's happening in the court uncritically. The important point about the structured relationship, as they call it, between the media and the primary institutional definers, so here the police, the judges who define what's happened, is that it permits the institutional definers, the police, the judges, to establish the initial definition or the primary interpretation of the topic in question. This is so important in joint enterprise because it's not about who did what, it's about constructing an interpretation of who people are and what may or may not have happened and what may or may not have been thought or foreseen. So this primary interpretation is really important, and therefore I think we start to see the significance of the media. But I also want to ask something of ourselves, because I think, you know, when we pick up our newspapers or we turn the telly on and I'm, you know, so much, you know, and some of it's, you know, killer girlfriends on Channel 5 or 24 Hours in Police Custody. And I hasten to say I use those two programmes because women in these cases have been mediated on both of those programmes without consent. You know, their time in police custody has been broadcast. Their case has been put on killer girlfriends. But when we're watching those programmes as a public, how do we engage with the objectification? So I use Crumenevo and Sidi here, and I say representing the other, in the cases of these women, is always a process of dominance and control in which the person represented is reduced to the object. So that objectification that's happening in the courtroom is kind of facilitated by us, is it? And I leave the question, really, who is culpable then for the injustice? And it is without doubt the courts and the judges. And but it can't just be left there, can it? It has to be asked as a broader question. So I kind of, that's my Q&A back to you, I suppose, is who's culpable for this injustice? Let me come off this screen now.
That was brilliant, both Becky and Gloria. Thank you so much. I've been following both your work for a very long time and found it really influential and informative on my own thinking as well as my own academic work and writing. That I think this new research that has been presented today really brings a new dimension and really challenges us to think about so many aspects of both this doctrine, but I think also the criminal justice system more generally, and of course these questions of the media. So we've got a few comments in the Q&A and in the chat. So I'm going to start with the Q&A because there's a few things that have come up. So the first question has arisen is, in joint enterprise cases, if an individual says, yes, John Smith was there, but I committed all the crime and it was me, John Smith had nothing to do with it, does that carry any weight in the other party being pardoned or given a lesser sentence?
We've got many, many cases where the principal has said, yes, it was me, I did it. And all that happens to them is that they get a lower sentence because they've admitted culpability. So in the Laura Mitchell case, the one Becky mentioned, the girl looking for her shoes in a car park, her and her boyfriend on one side of the car park looking for her shoes, three other boys run to this side of the car park 6 minutes later, and one of them delivers a blow to somebody's neck, second blow is fatal. All five get convicted of joint enterprise murder, even the two that are this side of the car park and didn't even know that that had happened. But the boy that did the murder, he held his hands up and said it was me, and he got a lesser sentence than Becky and Michael. Not Becky, Laura. So no, it doesn't. It, even if you try and do the right thing, it's not necessarily going to be help you.
Yeah, there's some stuff in the report about plea bargaining. There's a section about it. So if somebody's interested in that, because that's where that really comes out, this idea of like, well, is this about the truth? Is it about justice? You know, or is it about sort of convictions? And there's this whole sort of, and it is really a backroom process. It's another hidden aspect of this process where this sort of dynamic of bargaining goes on. And it's really problematic because, like Gloria says, what happens in these cases, often the women get longer than people who've actually engaged in the murder, the violent offence.
Interesting. And that actually links to a comment that someone has made in the chat, which I'll just read out, which someone has said, I think that saying, show me your company and I will tell you who you are, is so wrong. And life situations are tossed out the window. And what the courts believe, happened is what they go by. This person says they prefer the French and Japanese criminal systems, which focus on finding the actual truth and not the me versus who the best talker but of course they will have their negatives. This person has conceded. So the next question that we have is someone thanks you very much for the excellent reports, Becky. Do you know the genders of the judges who handed down these sentences? I assume it's the ones that you were quoting.
Yeah, and you know what, it's so interesting because you would have initially kind of thought, I mean, when you see the judge's name, often judge and a surname. So, but we did do some of this. This is a piece of work to be done. So if there's a student out there who is interested in doing a project, or this is a piece of work to be done, to be thinking about who the judges are and maybe the gender or even the ethnicity of the judges. So there's one case in particular, it's in the report, it's called the case of Carrie. And we look at it because there's something really strange about this case, in that the judge is really clear that this girl, she's 15 at the time and everybody's drunk and it's around New Year's Eve, and that she couldn't have engaged in any violence, that she was too drunk to really know what was going on. She'd actually been stabbed in the cheek and so was herself a victim of violent crime. Yet, even in these summing up comments where the judge really seeks to almost suggest that the law can't be passed against this girl, she's convicted of manslaughter. And I remember thinking, who is this judge? And I looked up the judge, and the judge is a female judge. She's actually the first senior black judge in the country who went into, she's been on the Court of Appeal and stuff as well. And so it's really difficult to think about the way in which, you know, the idea of representation, if a female judge looked over a case, would it change things? If a black judge oversaw the case of a group of young people from the black community, would it change the outcome? And I think it takes us down a path that doesn't see these issues as institutional or structural. Yes, individuals should be accountable for what they do in those processes, but I think there are any number of female judges who have said, and really cranked up the gendered narratives around motherhood in these cases, you know, the feral mothers, and, you know, these have come out of the mouths of female judges. And so I think there's something to look at more systematically there, but the cases that I can think of don't push me in the direction that you might expect. Glow might have something to say as well there.
Yeah, no, I think it's again, it's also the lack of accountability that you can't actually challenge what a judge perception. I mean, I remember we read that summing up from a particular judge, a female judge, and it was like something out of the 18th century. Honestly, the language she was using, the way she was describing the girls in the case, it was so vile that. And they're not impartial. They're just not impartial. They are directing the jury. Apparently in the 18th century, there was one particular judge who, when he heard evidence that he didn't like, he would do that to make out that it was, well, you know what he's doing. But and I don't think we've changed. I think we've still got individuals like that in our courts, especially in our senior courts, because the only way you're going to get appointed onto the, is, you know, you've got to prosecute, and then you've got to be a successful prosecutor, and then you've got to toe the line, and then you can become a judge, and then as a judge you're not going to rock the boat, because it's all my learned friend and my brethren, and it's just not fit for purpose. Our system's not fit for purpose. It's in systematically it's racist, it's yeah. And I do think one of the people, you know, the group that should be held accountable, but it's not just the judges, this is the police as well. The police, you know, there's this sort of disconnect where the police blame the CPS, and the CPS say it's the police, you know, the police. But someone is saying there's enough evidence to charge these people for murder. Someone's got to be held accountable to say, and they don't. They just say, well, it's joint enterprise.
But don't you think, Lord, sorry to get into, because this to me is something we've really thought about, like looking at the charge policy. And it's, again, it's a thread that I've really focused on lots more recently that I hadn't really thought about so much before. And it's the two tests. I'm not sure, is it the evidence test or is it the public interest test? And I think this, and again, and this is where for me, the political rhetoric, where did this come from? Who said we needed to because, you know, these laws re-emerged probably in the last 20 years really significantly. And that comes from a political and social context. It comes from a media. The kind of the public interest test relates to this idea of what do we think the public wants, and do we get that from our media, or where do we get that from? You know, there's actually academic evidence to suggest that the public wouldn't want joint enterprise, a fantastic academic empirical piece of work, I think. But, you know, this idea of, like you say, yes, it's evidence, but I also think it's this perception of what the public want, and this public interest test as well.
Yeah, can I just add on to that one as well, because when I first did the first interview I ever did on Radio 4 was after Charlie Faulkner, who was Lord Chancellor at the time.
Yeah.
And you know, we were talking about this idea of black on black crime, that same sort of, and Faulkner said, well, perhaps we need, you know, maybe the public won't agree with it, but perhaps we need draconian laws like joint enterprise to stop people killing one, you know, it's knife crime. Now, only 2 weeks ago, the chief senior police officer, when he was questioned about the idea that we're constantly, you know, black youth are being constantly stopped and searched 10 times more, I'd make figures up, than white youth. And he said, well, it's the, and this is 2 weeks ago, you know, it's the black kids, if we're having to stop them, it's because they are killing the other black kids. It's the same thing the media want to put into our heads, that we think that you know, that there's some kind of persistent evil with young people in general, but definitely young black people black and brown people. So it's something that's so difficult to break that narrative, because people have been brainwashed into believing it, and brainwashed into believing that joint enterprise actually is effective. But it's not, because if it was, we wouldn't have the same kind of levels of knife crime that we still have. Young people still don't know anything about it, and even if they do, they don't believe it. They don't think it's fair. They don't agree with it. Young people have a very innate sense of justice, And no one with any sense would think that joint enterprise makes sense. So, yeah.
So we've just got a quick comment from Cressida, who was kind of responding to something you guys were saying before. So Cressida has said that some Black and Asian doctors or lawyers or others are actually worse than maybe white racist counterparts, as they feel they have to assimilate to get into the positions they're in. And I think there are some interesting studies on this in the United States, where there's obviously a very high proportion of Black police officers, for instance, in the NYPD and the LAPD, which obviously has far worse levels of racism and racial violence than, or certainly racial violence anyway, than we have here in this country. And similarly with Black judges as well. So I think that's an important contribution. Okay, next question from Anna Marie, who asks, instead of punishing the accused people, would it be better to offer mental and financial support in order to change their vision about crime? Why is the justice system not working in this way? How would it be if it worked in this way?
I mean, I'll start there. I mean, is that okay, Gloria? Am I right to? Yeah. I mean, it's difficult because with the joint enterprise cases, you have to keep reminding yourself they didn't commit the crime. So this idea of sort of a more investing in more rehabilitative strategies, I think probably what Anna Marie's saying is more investing in more social support. And on one level, that rings right, you know, that you'll see. And we, Catherine and I, as the co-authors of this report, really struggled with the extent to which we wanted to sort of open up a discussion about the women's lives that had shaped before the event. And we chose to really be careful around that, because for us, the focus is the injustice of joint enterprise. But it's true, you know, from the women's accounts that a substantial number, so over half, have experienced, you know, violence at multiple times in their life, sexual violence, domestic violence with co-defendants and otherwise, the levels of alcohol dependency and drug use for some of the women are really high, you know. So yeah, absolutely, there's a context going on for some women in these, in their lives, that would say society is failing to protect women and girls' bodies, and failing to provide the support and health needs that they have. But I think, to me, we need to kind of divorce two things. It's like public health models to address youth violence. We couple the two things up to our peril, because you then almost suggest that one strategy is replacing the other. Injustice is injustice, and we have to expose it and fight it. And yes, there is a broader set of issues around social injustice that would mean that we would invest better, we would make society less unequal. We would enable people to have the things they need to live their lives safely and comfortably. Absolutely. But I kind of don't think that I would advance the argument on the basis that that would solve the injustice of joint enterprise. I think the two things have to be really carefully separated. And it's something it's a struggle. I think it's a struggle for a lot of people who write around women in the criminal justice system, that we fall into a trap of thinking it's okay to talk about the vulnerabilities of women and talk about offending and sort of mix these things together as if they can be understood together. You know, for me, less than 10% of reported crime is prosecuted. It's a funnel. So for me, the process of criminalisation, who ends up in the courtroom, who ends up in the prison, whether that's in joint enterprise or in other, is an important question to answer on its own, outside of kind of questions around wider sort of societal causes of crime and harm, if that makes sense.
I'd pick up on that as well. I mean, when we had the 2011 riots, you know, 10 years ago coming up this summer, it was Keir Starmer, who was DPP at the time, who said, let's, you know, 24-hour courtrooms too. And a lot of those young people were prosecuted for stealing bottles of water or whatever they, you know. They weren't looking at this as actually, why have we got this social unrest because of the murder of Mark Duggan? They weren't actually trying to figure out what was going wrong in our society. They just went straight to the punishment side of it and lock up these dissenting voices to that situation. And that is where we're at anyway, as a society. We don't focus on what is going wrong in our communities? Why are young people, you know, on the streets? Why are there no youth services anymore? We're not looking at those kind of issues. We're just looking at the other end of it. And let's just fill up Felton with young black boys because no one gives a shit. So it's so frustrating because actually I don't think we're angry enough. I was saying this earlier today in another webinar that, you know, the fact that you've got children in prisons and in secure centres. And I went to this lecture once with Chris Grayling about child lifers, and he said, it costs more to put four children to Eton than it costs to send them to a secure unit. And I'm looking like, well, send them to Eton then. Don't send them to somewhere they're going to be brutalised. Definitely come out with mental health problems. And what's going on right now, where prisoners are being locked up for 23 and a half hours a day. And this is young people. I mean, can you imagine teenagers in places like Felton, 23 and a half hours a day, they're locked in a cell. And it's a cell. It's a tiny, tiny room, often with the you know, they're not mattresses. They're like little plastic sheeting with no light, no natural light, no, you know. And it's a place of violence, a place of brutality. And we don't examine that in our society. We don't examine prisons enough. The press are not allowed to go into prisons. We're not allowed to show what actually goes on in there. Every now and then you get a ridiculous program about what goes on in Gartree or somewhere like that. But we're not really showing why we send people to prison, what happens to them in prison. Yeah. And I think someone said in the chat, they are hugely corporate. Commercial, you know, there's lots of businesses that have got people working for them in prison, you know, including Amazon and Marks and Spencers and DHS. The sofa, I need a new sofa and I can't buy one from DHL with this because they're made in prisons. You know, it's as simple as that.
It's interesting to see the chat and also hear Glow, because it's, you know, when it's, I think somebody also asked a question whether I believe in prison abolition. Was that a question, Adam, that I saw?
Oh, that was the next one coming up. Yeah, right. So you're welcome to take that now.
And I think it links with, I think it was questioned about, was it somebody in the chat who was kind of saying that, you know, the idea of addressing issues in prison, the criminal system, and issues in mental health and social need is connected. And I don't mean to say it's not connected, but I think that there's something about the way in which, and I suppose it then it leans into this idea of prison abolition or police abolition, defunding the police. I think we need to, those things must be done because of the harms that they produce. That we then also need to much better invest in mental health services and in social care and support. Yes, that much has happened, but I kind of don't want to see the two things almost like coupled together, that we do want to do the other, or because I think that the harms and injustice of the criminal justice system are kind of there whether we're investing or not. Like if you think back to the New Labour period, there was a huge investment, you know, we were tough on crime, tough on the causes of crime. You know, there was massive investment into communities and through Sure Start and youth centres and everything. But the prisons are full. There were still those harms and injustices and everything else going on. And so there's something about sort of, yeah, fighting and getting angry and demanding, you know, demanding the support and protection that children need, that young people need, that women who face violence and harms in their homes, in their communities need, that young people, you know, living in poverty day in, day out need. But that has to be kind of, there is another fight alongside it, but the two are, and again, it's a personal reflection in some ways, thinking about how sometimes when we try and have these conversations too closely together, it leans into kind of incremental and reformist sort of strategies around, well, let's reduce the women's prison population and try and invest it in women's centres. And it's like, yeah, we need women's centres, or we need spaces where women can get support and help, whether that's a women's centre, I don't know. Some women don't really want to go women's centres. They find those spaces, you know, are not really for them. So what do we need? We need spaces where women can go and get support and feel safe. But that shouldn't be coupled to the fact that we need to reduce the prison population. yes, we should be abolishing the use of prison for its own argument. It's a failed strategy to manage crime, to manage harm, to manage anything in society. So, you know, for the question, yes, I would want to see the abolition of joint enterprise and the prison system. But I suppose for me, the question left me and Catherine with bigger questions around kind of the failure of the justice system, because it hasn't protected the bodies or the lives of so many of these women as they've been women and girls, yet it's then also sought to criminalise. And there's something really deeply insidious about a system that fails you as a victim and then criminalises you, offender, when you haven't even done anything. You know, there's something deeply problematic about a system that kind of fails on both of its own sort of aims and counts. And yeah.
Okay, we've got a comment from an anonymous attendee about zemiology, which I've just Googled before reading it out, which is apparently the study of social harm. So this kind of area of study deals with the focus on harm on society and fixing it through state and economic supports for the wider picture of what causes harm, which our criminal justice system separates individually, and it's a never-ending cycle. So I think that kind of links to what I guess you were saying to a degree, maybe, Becky, about looking at those wider harms.
It's funny when you introduced me, Adam, and you said, oh, Becky, she works in criminology. I always feel there is an element of, you know, you're working in that very space that sort of criminology as a discipline is often part of the problem as well, you know. Zemiology, Gloria was on a session this morning with Steve Toombs around After Strange Regime. I mean, Steve Toombs and others are central to that kind of zemiological project, why harm actually matters more than crime. You know, if we focused on harm and, you know, and some of the real serious harms around large scale poverty, health and safety, Grenfell, other things, you know, we can't do that in the criminal justice system, can we? You know, we can't respond to those issues and harms. So, yeah, I would encourage people to look at that. There's a brilliant paper, CCJS. It's called Criminal Obsessions, Why Harm Matters More Than Crime, which is a great great sort of starting point and paper to look at.
So we've got another question. Maybe this is more for Gloria to talk about the work that Jenka does, but the question is just simply, what can the public do to bring about change in relation to joint enterprise?
Oh, thank you for that question. They can get behind us. They can, one of the things we decided this morning, Caroline Willow was on the webinar I did this morning. She's Article 39, which is to end child imprisonment, which has been something Jenga have been calling for since 2018 when we relaunched our campaign. We should be demanding that mandatory sentences are abolished as well. That was Schedule 21 that was brought in again by the Blair government, because they want to be, it's always governments want to be seen as tough on crime. And the IPPs are part of that. I did see in the chat someone was saying you need more prisons to, you know, to fill up the places. Well, we went from 45,000 people in prisons 20 years ago to now 90, which is full capacity. So then you get someone like the prisons minister, Lucy Fraser, going on Women's Hour saying, well, we're going to build a new women's prison for 500 prisoners. And the woman, the interviewer asked her why, and she said, because we are going to recruit 200 new police officers. And where's that correlation? What do you mean you need a bigger prison just because you've got more? It's nuts. So the main thing, Jenga, our big push now is, one, we need public support, and we need, we definitely need, you know, people to kind of get behind us. But we're going to launch a private members bill in March the 17th, if it's ready. It's in a consultation stage at the moment. And that private members bill is to get rid of the substantial injustice. So we're saying that the bar is too high now, that no one can go back to the Court of Appeal. There's no point, because they're just knocking everybody back. Because if you let through one person with autism, then all the other prisoners that we've got that got autism have got precedent. If you let through a girl looking for her shoes because she didn't even know someone was going to kick somebody 6 minutes later, you set precedent so other people who are secondary parties who are not at the scene can all go back to the court. So that's where we're at. We're at a stumbling block in terms of substantial injustice. So we're launching this private members bill, which any street, everybody get behind us and help us with that, because it's our first real big foray into it's hugely political what we're doing, but this is our first sort of really political move that is actually trying to get a bill that says enough is enough. We need to stop this. We need to stop because they're still using joint enterprise. They're still, you know, whether they call it parasitic excess or a liability, or whether they call it conditional intent. I mean, if you see any case or anything in the news that's got more than one defendant, or if it's got a group of defendant, that's going to be a joint enterprise. So follow it, report on it, send us information on it. We can't do. We're not lawyers. We're just campaigners, and we've got to be quite careful that people thinking that we can jump in and wave the magic wand and get their loved one free. We're trying, but we can't do that. So what we've got to do is all just, you know, get behind the bill. The girl who's running it is she's a lawyer now, Charlotte Henry. Her brother is Alex Henry, the boy that was autistic, and Lord Chief Justice said that her mum had taught him to be autistic. I mean, that in itself, I say that story all the time because people just go, what? And think, you know, would someone in a senior position of law actually say, oh, no, you're pretending to be autistic? I mean, really? So, but she's asking for Jeb, not volunteers, but people to get behind the bill and students, mainly students that are going to help her advocate the bill, get it out to MPs, get it out to the Lords. We need to find some sympathetic Lords that will then, there's a lot of Lords that have got legal backgrounds, but it's not going to be an easy ask, but you know, with a lot of support, with a lot of people behind us, I think it can happen. Hello, Dave. But that's our big push, the joint enterprise bill, March 17th. And I think with that, we'll go out with a new petition. But we have got a petition on our website. Our website is jointenterprise.co. Do have a look. There's a lot of information on there because we've done a lot of work.
Yeah. Adam, I've just asked for Dave to maybe come and join in the panel, if that's okay.
Hi there, how you doing?
Hi, Dave.
So yep. I think, you know, Dave, there's been questions, you know, about what can people do, but also, you know, do you want to introduce yourself and maybe just give your reflections on some of the things Gloria and I have been saying today?
Yeah, so obviously Dave and Claire Warren, parents of Zoe Warren, who was sentenced to life for a murder she didn't commit, to 17 years, and it's a joint enterprise murder, and it's all obviously she's been part of Becky and Catherine's report. You know, and we have support with Jengba, but as parents, you don't really know. You touched on about how people get on in this with this knowing about the charges of joint enterprise. Where I never knew. No one knows. You know, because it's one of those things in life where if it doesn't affect you, who gives a damn sort of thing? Because you don't really want to know. It's only when you're involved and you go, oh my God, it's all gone pear shaped, and you have to sort of understand how and rapidly catch up with what is going on with what's going on with our daughter's case, and understand what the ramifications are. You know, our daughter gives an account of what happened, and it's pretty clear that she didn't commit the murder, but she's gone away for 17 years for something she didn't do. And you go after it, you think, Christ, how do you manage that? You know, and touching on Becky's point about the media, you know, the media hammered Zoe. The Chronicle, we're based in the Newcastle area, so Newcastle Evening Chronicle, they're part of Trinity Group of papers, as a part of the Mirror, you know, for the Mirror, and they hammered her. They absolutely hammered her. She was on Killer Girlfriends, and the family, you know, I understand the family and understand how they feel about this case. But everyone, when you're in this position, everyone has a free rein to pile on top of you, and you don't have a voice because you're the parents of a guilty person, and the guilty person is a guilty person, they're in prison, they go, won't see the program, they may see the program, and they're locked in a little room. What do they do about that? There's no support. They can't back up from that and say, well, hang on a minute, you know, there's a little bit more to this than meets the eye. And so it's just an utter nightmare, you know. The media don't care about you. They just want to sell papers. But the things they write in the paper and what they said about Zoe, you know, about and in the report aspect, they mentioned how she's a party girl. But it's just so unfair.
I think, Dave, just to say as well, so Dave and Claire were really brave enough to want to be part of the report launch. And I say brave because, yeah, the pile-on is hurtful, and you know, it's hard, and it's so to be brave to come with the launch. But you know, our experience of doing that launch, and I say ours collectively with Jemba, with the families, was when you're trying to then launch with the media, what's fascinating is the media want families, so they want to report on our research and the campaign. Brilliant. Have you got some families? Yeah, of course. Or prisoners? Okay, well, let's try and talk about this. They immediately go back to the media that's already been printed and say, oh no, can we get somebody that's a bit more sympathetic, please? Can we get somebody who, you know, and you kind of, the story has been fixed, and that pile on, I mean, it keeps going, doesn't it, Dave? Because yeah. Once that case becomes notorious in the media, it becomes sort of a nice little go-to case for future media, and it's almost as if it's like the legal process, this long road back that's almost, you know, well, nigh on impossible, because in the same way as once the conviction has been made, it's an impossible, once the story has been fixed, you know, we see it with Hillsborough, we see it with Grenfell, we see it with bigger kind of situations and you know, and tragic events, but it is, I can almost hasten to guess that it probably has happened to every family of the women. You know, there was media on all these cases, particularly local media, you know, as Dave said.
I mean, it becomes a label. I mean, she's a party girl, you know, and that is just so unfair. But that label sticks, and that's forever. It's in the ether. You only have got to Google it, and it's going to be there forever unless, you can get hold of Google, and I know you can get stuff removed, but it doesn't really matter. It will surface somewhere else, you know, and we found out something just this week. It's on the crime and investigation. I was saying to Becky earlier, you know, it's about Murder Town, and that Zoe's not on the actual program, but on the website they put a little bit about her, and just out of coincidence, it happens to be Zoe Warren, yada yada yada, and you go, well, wow, you know, they call her an evil temptress, you know, I don't have to really explain it. I mean, for all those families out there, poor sods who have their loved ones in jail. Something they didn't do. They'll all be experiencing the same thing, and it's just a terrible way for us to feel about how this goes on, because no one really cares about you. And I go back to the bit about the beginning. You know, I never knew anything about joint enterprise, and because you don't, you just want those things in life. You don't want to know about that. Well, it's not palatable. You know, let's face it, murder isn't sexy. Let's be brutally honest. And when it happens, you go, oh my god. And you are stuck in this time warp of just a nutter. It's, I don't know what to say, really. I just find it. I still catch myself in the mornings. And I think to myself, you know, how the hell do we get here? You know, what happened? You know, the reporter that reported on Zoe is still trying to get in touch with us now, even though she hammered her. But because she's seen something from the stories of injustice and the House of Commons briefing, she's gone. She wants to know more and have a little bit of say. But one of the reporters who was in the trial, Gavin Havery from the Northern Echo, he was on Killer Girlfriends, and he's spouting stuff about something he doesn't really know, because he doesn't know about Zoe. I've got the defence files. I know what's happened now in the case. And I go, what about the other three people? What about the certain aspects weren't disclosed? You know, the police... were very sympathetic to us, because our daughter was NFA'd. She hadn't committed the crime, and she was no further action. She'd actually performed CPR and saved the guy's life a few hours beforehand. And then as soon as she's arrested, that's it. The shutters come down. You're on the other side now. And no matter what you say to them, and you know there's something wrong, but they don't want to know. They just don't want to know. And you're stuck in where you are.
that idea that you're on its sides, isn't it? You're on, it is, yeah, that adversarial nature, and it's so there in joint enterprise. Gloria talked about it before, you know, it is, and it's hard not to lean into those sort of conspiracy theories of like, well, is this a gate? You know, like for the system, is it about the numbers of the people they can convict or the amount of years, or is it, you know, it's very difficult because you see people being sort of abused and moved from. And I think in the women's cases that was seen, you know, one minute they are a witness and a victim and the next minute they are the culpable offender, you know.
I mean, I remember Gloria saying to us in the early days, she goes, you know, some of these policemen, you know, they'll get awards and promotion stuff. And I thought to myself at the time, no, that can't be the case. It has happened. Mm-hmm. It has happened. It was something that happened with Zoe just before that. Where, I mean, she'd been raped by a guy. The police lied about the detail, the file going to the CPS. The guy got reprimanded, but his supervision got an award and a promotion or whatever out of it, you know. And you think to yourself, it does happen. Because at first you think that, you know, it's one of these conspiracy theory things, you know, but it does happen. And because we've experienced it, you know, and I go, well, you know, and I've seen a lot in my life, and I think, well, you know, I didn't think that'd be the case, but it is, you know. And it's I use this tagline, target rates of conviction. Without a shadow of a doubt, the police, you know, they've got their own careers, as sad as it is to say, but I don't believe they're always as trustworthy and honest as they make out to be, because ultimately they've got to do their job. So, and I think they manipulate aspects to make sure they seem to be doing their job at the detriment of others who take up that tariff, excuse the analogy, but it's a tariff. It's a life tariff in this case for our daughter, but it's a tariff that we all pick up on the basis the police want to win.
Thanks so much for your contributions, Dave. It's really important to have those kinds of Amir first-hand reports, and we really appreciate your contributions. Thank you. There are a couple of other questions which have come from the audience. Would it be okay if we just ask them, because we're so we've got time? So the first question, I think it was relating to something you were saying earlier, Becky, which someone asks, do you think women are treated harshly by the criminal justice system due to their punishments by species views that women should be the innocent, good housekeeping, submissive wife or woman? So as sort of like a punishment and not a sympathetic view of the women's abuse, or even blaming women for their own abuse?
I think in some ways the answer would be yes. And, you know, these cases are sort of testament to that. Absolutely. And you know, the quote I use at the end from Baroness Kennedy, you know, misogyny, that misogynistic view of when women, you know, deviate from those expected norms, you know, gendered norms, feminine norms within society, that becomes central to that court process. But I think it's really important to sort of acknowledge that it's not about sort of women as a universal experience. Women don't experience the criminal justice system universally, you know, depending on who you are and how you're perceived. So for me, as a, you know, a white female, middle class, got my job at my university, I think I would be able to navigate the system very differently. And there were some cases, and it's in the report, we talk about the idea of kind of the sympathetic judge, and because it's sometimes the judge that will perhaps start to defend a woman in the courtroom, but it is because they are perceived as the right type of woman, or it may be that that woman is perceived to be almost like the fallen angels. She's not culpable because she's been influenced by other people, or, you know. And I think we see then that the class stigma becomes central to that, and racist tropes and stereotypes. So as I started out, you know, why is it that Black, Asian, minoritized women are convicted for lesser offenses yet given the same sentences as their white counterparts convicted of murder and manslaughter? And I suppose it's that idea that I don't think we can say women are treated more leniently or more harshly in a universal way. I think we need to ask the question around, well, how is the criminal justice system perceiving different individual women and different groups of women. And it doesn't happen in a kind of a naturally linear way, because I think sometimes, like I tried to show in a couple of the quotes, you might be a middle-class woman and educated, but actually if it suits the prosecution and the police that day, you might be the calculated knowing. So your education, your background could be also used. So I think there's something more complex to understand. But yeah, in these cases, I think it's fair to say there's plenty of evidence that women whose character can be questioned in different ways will be experiencing more severe punishments. I think that, yeah, that can be said.
Someone has asked a question about the CPS charging teenagers for domestics during lockdown. I know that's obviously not that connected to exactly what we've been talking about. I'm not sure if anyone's able to talk about that. That's a question from Cressida.
I wouldn't be able to talk to that, I don't think myself, no.
I know that there was a report by Liberty, which if I have time, I'll Google and put into the chat, which did look at the way in which the CPS was charging young people during the lockdown. So I'll try to get that in the chat before the end of the event, Cressida. Sorry, we're not able to respond to that. Another question asks, so this goes back to the public test evidence kind of thing that you were talking about earlier. Public test seems definitely more important to the prosecution. We wouldn't have so many injustices in our criminal cases because of evidence, if it mainly relied on evidence. So I guess that's more of a comment. But do you guys think that it's if the focus was more on evidence than on a public test or the public interest, I guess, then things would be fairer? Or
I think it's something we've got to open up and understand, and this is the hidden aspect of it. And you know, if you look at our calls to action at the end of the report, one of them is to really, I mean, there are four main ones that look at what we do going forward, and some of this is about being able to have a transparent review of charging policy and prosecution decision making. You know, there's questions about police decision making in this, and so I think part of the problem is, you know, we're trying on the basis of cases, but even, I mean, Gloria, Pastor Glow, because people can't even get their own charging decision documentation, so they don't know on the basis of, is it, you know, which test has been applied in order to make their charge decision. That's right, isn't it, Gloria?
Yeah, the problem, I mean, not problem, but one of the things we've found is that most families come to Jengba post-conviction, because when you're in the trial process, you're the rabbit's in the headlight, like Dave said, you know, families, I mean, there's a massive research project that should be done in the fact that the majority of our prisoners, our people we're supporting as a joint enterprise, have got no criminal background. So you know, it's a psychologist's wet dream. How do you go from having no criminal background to actually becoming a murderer? It doesn't make any sense. And so to then try and get charging decisions, because we do want to see them, because they're not in the ether. There must be something the police are saying, right, we've got this bit of evidence on this individual, and we've got this evidence on this individual, and then, you know, put it there, show us the evidence. Don't bag up assumptions that you must have known what someone else was going to do. So, but it's very, very difficult. And then once you get post-conviction, it's really hard for prisoners to try and get their legal paperwork. And it's something actually Dave pointed out, that we really need to do something on, you know, our website for first steps for families. So once you actually get convicted, you need to kind of know immediately what to do, because that first thing you need to do is try and get your judge summing up. But to last week, some 21-year-old boys all got, they got 23 and 22. We're getting sentences longer than people have been on the planet. But and all the families have contacted us, and the legals themselves are just being awful. They're just saying, no, there's no grounds for appeal, because there's no money in appeals. That's the other thing as well. There's lots and lots of money in trials and getting people convicted of murders. And that's one of the reasons why joint enterprises pervaded for so long, because the lawyers weren't going to stand up and go, you know, actually, this isn't right. Not all of them. There are some decent lawyers out there, really, really. But there's a lot of law firms out there that really need to hang their heads in shame, because they don't care about their clients. They really genuinely don't. Too many of our cases meet their barrister or their QC on the day of the trial. They come out with the same kind of language that, you know, Becky has identified. You know, if it's going to be character assassination is one thing, but just, you know, anything that you can. I mean, my boy was told, because he's a really polite, young, black, articulate man. Well, he was 19 at the time, so a young man. Because he did GCSE drama, this is fraud. That's what the prosecution said. What he's presenting in court is not true, because he did GCSE drama, so he's pretending to be this young, brilliant, articulate man. I mean, how do you fight something like that? Jordan Cunliffe was told by the prosecutor that he was lying, that he could see. He was 15-year-old in a court, an adult court. You're lying, you can see, can't you? They spent, he was in the dock for 45 minutes fighting for it. 45 minutes, that's all the time they spent on him. And most of that was about the fact that he'd been playing football earlier in the day. And yes, he had. But they had in the Olympics, you had blind football. So, you know, it is just anything, like we've been saying, it's an adversarial system, anything to get a prosecution, anything to get a result. It's not about justice, it's about getting a result. And then overturning that result is the hardest thing that all of our families are experiencing. That it's just because there's no evidence to prosecute. So to you know, point to evidence. But often if there is evidence pointing to innocence, it's batted away. And often by defense lawyers, they don't use evidence that can prove innocence. They just think their clients are as guilty as the prosecution do. So rather grim. We fight it. If we don't fight it, we're part of the problem.
Right. I just want to answer, we're coming to the end now, so I just want to thank so much to Dave Warren, to Gloria Morrison, and to Becky Clarke for your contribution this afternoon, for informing us about all of these different aspects of joint enterprise, both things that we might be familiar with before if we're familiar with joint enterprise, but certainly I know I've learned lots about the legal doctrine. I'm sure lots of people have as well. In the chat is the link to the Jengaba website, so you can learn about the case of Dave Warren's daughter, as well as the work that Gloria and other people are doing with Jengaba. I've also linked to Becky's recent report as well, if people want to read that in more detail. So yeah, I just want to end by thanking once again everyone for joining us, both people in the audience and all of our speakers, and enjoy the rest of your evenings. Thank you so much.